What is up, engine heads? In today's video, we're talking about headers or exhaust manifolds slash turbo manifolds. First, we're going to explain what they actually do, and then we're going to compare OEM short log style cast exhaust manifolds versus aftermarket welded tubular equal length manifolds like this beauty from Weldspeed right here. By doing this comparison, we're going to see how different designs and materials influence the behavior and performance of your engine. So as the name very obviously suggests, the exhaust manifold provides an exit pathway for the exhaust gases coming out of your engine. It connects your cylinder head to the rest of your exhaust system. It's always directly bolted onto the cylinder head, and when the exhaust gases exit from the exhaust port, the exhaust manifold is the first thing they see. So obviously the exhaust manifold doesn't actually do anything. It's a passive part. It's a collection of pathways for the exhaust gases. However, the shape, length, and diameter of these pathways can play an important part in the performance and character of your engine. Now, exhaust manifolds will be very different on turbocharged and naturally aspirated engines, obviously due to the fact that a turbocharged engine is going to have a turbo bolted directly onto the exhaust manifold and then the rest of the exhaust system bolted onto the turbine housing of the turbocharger. On a naturally aspirated engine, the exhaust manifold is connected directly to the rest of the exhaust system without any sort of turbocharger in between. The design of the exhaust manifold influences two main things: scavenging and exhaust back pressure. And then these two things influence the power, torque, responsiveness, and efficiency of your engine. So let's start with scavenging. What is scavenging? Well, in simplest terms, it's using the exiting of the exhaust gases to ease and improve the entry of the intake charge with the goal of improving performance. So let's see how exactly does it work. Well, as you probably know, when combustion occurs inside the engine, it dramatically increases the pressure inside the cylinder and the combustion chamber. This pressure, of course, pushes the piston downward. And when the piston reaches the bottommost position of its travel, bottom dead center, the combustion stroke ends. The piston reverses its direction of travel and starts moving upward, during which the upward motion of the piston is used to push out the exhaust gases remaining from combustion out of the engine. When the exhaust valve opens, it allows the exhaust gases, now pressurized by the piston, to escape out of the chamber and into the exhaust manifold. In fact, the difference in pressure between the gases inside the chamber and the pressure inside the exhaust manifold when the exhaust valve opens is so great that it creates a positive pressure wave moving at great speed through the exhaust manifold. This positive pressure wave, or expansion wave as it's also known, travels faster than the exhaust gases themselves. It actually moves at the local speed of sound, which is around 1,400 kilometers per hour in the very hot environment of the exhaust manifold. And when this positive pressure wave encounters any sort of significant change in the shape or diameter of the exhaust manifold, for example, when it reaches an exhaust collector, it gets reflected back. And the reflected pressure wave undergoes a reversal in the sense that it changes from a positive to a negative pressure wave and travels back to the combustion chamber. Now, a positive pressure wave has pressure higher than atmospheric, and a negative pressure wave has pressure lower than atmospheric. So as the negative pressure wave travels back towards the combustion chamber, it reduces pressure along its travel path, which helps evacuate any remaining exhaust gases. But also when it gets into the combustion chamber, it reduces the pressure inside it. And this is very important for a naturally aspirated engine, because as we know, in a naturally aspirated engine, the intake air, or the air coming into it, is always at atmospheric pressure. There's no turbo or supercharger to generate additional pressure to push the air into the engine. Instead, the only pressure pushing the air into a naturally aspirated engine is the pressure of the atmosphere outside the engine. So if we imagine that the piston moving down the bore inside the engine can create a perfect vacuum or a perfect absence of pressure, then in a naturally aspirated engine, there's only 14.7 psi or 1 bar of pressure pushing the air into the engine, and that's only when we're at sea level. Now, there are two prerequisites for the piston to be able to generate a good vacuum. The first one is that there must be no remaining leftover exhaust gases in the cylinder, and the second one is that the piston has to move far enough down the bore to generate sufficient vacuum. Now, this is when the negative pressure wave comes in. First of all, it occurs very near TDC, right when the exhaust stroke is ending and the intake stroke is beginning. It also occurs when both the exhaust and the intake valve is open. Both valves must be open, because without valve overlap, there is no scavenging. Now, as we already said, the negative pressure wave evacuates all the remaining exhaust gases, so it fulfills our first prerequisite for a good vacuum. But it also does a bonus thing. When it gets into the combustion chamber, very near TDC, it lowers the pressure inside the combustion chamber even before the piston generates enough vacuum and even before it goes far enough down the bore. And this means that the entry of the air and fuel into the chamber begins sooner and occurs faster than without scavenging, which means that more air and fuel can get into the chamber, which of course results in a more powerful combustion and better performance. Now, for the negative pressure wave to be able to do its thing, the timing must be right. It must come into the chamber at the correct time. And the correct timing is right before the exhaust valve closes and when the intake valve has already started opening. Obviously, your camshaft specs are important because, as we said, if there's no valve overlap here, there won't be any scavenging. But the other key factor is the diameter and the length of your exhaust manifold primary tubes. They determine the timing of the negative pressure wave. So the distance from the cylinder head from the beginning of the exhaust manifold to the first large change in diameter of the exhaust manifold determines when the negative pressure wave starts traveling back to the chamber and how long it takes to get there. So if the primary tubes are too long, then the negative pressure wave will start traveling back to the chamber later and it will take longer to get back into the chamber, and if it comes too late, it's going to hit a closed exhaust valve and no scavenging will occur. If the primary tubes are too short, then the negative pressure wave will start traveling sooner and it will reach the chamber faster, and if it arrives too early, it's going to hit a closed intake valve. Again, it won't be able to do any scavenging. So what is the ideal primary tube length? Well, fortunately, you can actually calculate it using a formula like this one. But to use the formula, you have to know your cam specs, because EVO or EVO is your exhaust valve opening duration at 0.05 inches of lift. When it comes to the RPM, your input is going to depend on what you're actually building. The general consensus is that for a street engine, it's best to input your peak torque RPM, while for a race engine, it's best to input your peak horsepower RPM. Now, this formula is sort of a general rule of thumb, and although there's a lot of other things to consider, it's still a pretty good starting point towards designing the ideal length of your exhaust manifold. But in addition to this, it also teaches us something important, and that is that scavenging cannot occur over the entire RPM band of the engine. That's impossible. Instead, scavenging is tuned to a particular, relatively narrow RPM range. The reason behind this is obvious, because over the entire RPM range of the engine, the piston speed is going to change, and so too are other factors like exhaust gas, velocity, and volume. On the other hand, the exhaust manifold is fixed. It cannot change its length as the engine is running, which means that the ideal timing of the negative pressure wave can only be tuned to achieve the best scavenging effects over, let's say, 1000 to 2500 RPM. Now, on a well-tuned exhaust system, the effects of scavenging can remove as much as 7 psi of pressure from the combustion chamber. This is obviously very important for a naturally aspirated engine, which only has 14.7 psi of pressure to work with. However, scavenging isn't really that important for turbocharged engines, because they can add 1 or even 2 atmospheres or bars of pressure into the intake charge, which dramatically increases the amount of air and fuel coming into the chamber as soon as the valve opens. You really don't need scavenging to help you, because you're already pushing on that air with a lot of additional pressure. Another factor why turbo engines and scavenging don't really work that well together is that scavenging needs valve overlap. And although some valve overlap can be beneficial in turbo engines as well, having the intake and exhaust valves open together for too long on a turbo engine means that you're actually sending the valuable pressurized air coming from the turbo out the exhaust. In other words, you're wasting the work of the turbocharger. So scavenging isn't really that important for turbocharged engines, because they can significantly increase the pressure of the intake air and they don't really have to rely on scavenging. However, there is a price to be paid for this, and this is that a turbocharger is going to be a bottleneck in your exhaust system that is going to increase the back pressure of your exhaust, which is going to increase the amount of work the engine has to do in order to fight against this back pressure to push out the exhaust gases. The reason behind this is that exhaust gases and pulses must be forced to hit the turbine wheel in a predetermined way. And to do this, the turbine inlet is going to have a dramatically reduced cross-sectional area compared to the rest of your exhaust manifold. This, of course, creates a sort of bottleneck which increases the back pressure in your exhaust manifold. Now, the amount of back pressure is determined by your turbo and your exhaust manifold design. The larger the turbo, the larger the turbine inlet, the less back pressure there's going to be. And although this will increase power, it will reduce engine responsiveness, because the larger the turbo, the larger and heavier the turbine wheel, the more exhaust gas volume is needed to get it up to speed. The other factor is, as we said, our exhaust manifold. The better designed it is, the more free-flowing it is, the less back pressure there's going to be, and the more power potential there's going to be. So now let's compare our OEM and aftermarket exhaust manifold to see exactly how this plays out in practice. Probably the first thing you'll notice between the two manifolds is runner length. The OEM cast manifold has shorter runners, and on top of that, they're of unequal length compared to the Weldspeed aftermarket manifold, where the runners are longer and of equal length. To understand how runner length influences exhaust manifold back pressure, we have to understand that back pressure in the manifold increases every time an exhaust valve opens and lets in exhaust gases into the manifold. Back pressure again then decreases when the exhaust gases leave the exhaust manifold. By making the runners longer, we enable a more free-flowing form or shape of the runners. And by making them of equal length, we ensure that each exhaust pulse spends an equal amount of time inside the runner. In other words, we ensure that each exhaust pulse takes the same amount of time to reach the turbocharger. Being the bottleneck of the system, the inlet into the turbo is where the exhaust gases slow down and accumulate and thus increase back pressure. By ensuring that each exhaust pulse takes the same amount of time to reach the turbocharger, we're feeding the turbo with evenly spaced and equally strong and equally hot exhaust pulses. But more importantly, by increasing and equalizing the length of the runners, we ensure that back pressure from one exhaust pulse has already reduced by the time the next exhaust pulse reaches the turbo. This of course reduces back pressure by preventing the exhaust gases from accumulating or stacking up at the turbo. This of course increases power, and in addition to this, it ensures that the piston of each cylinder has to work against the same amount of back pressure when it's trying to push out the exhaust gases. The situation is obviously very different in the OEM log style manifold. As you can see, the shorter length of the runners results in a more restrictive shape of the runners, which means that the exhaust gases have to make a pretty sharp turn to go into the turbocharger, which of course reduces their speed and builds up back pressure. Another clear difference is that the exhaust runners of the aftermarket Weldspeed manifold are completely separate before they reach the collector at the turbo. In contrast to this, the OEM runners are actually feeding into each other. They intertwine, so to say, which again helps them stack up and increase back pressure. Another important factor is the unequal length of the runners. If we assume a typical inline 4 firing order of 1, 3, 4, 2, we can see that the exhaust pulse from cylinder number 4 is going to take the longest to reach the turbo because it obviously has the longest runner. Now, cylinder number 2, which is fired after cylinder 4, has the shortest runner, which means that its exhaust pulse is going to take the least amount of time to reach the turbo. So this means that by the time that exhaust pulse from cylinder number 4 reaches the turbo, cylinder number 2 will have already started sending out its exhaust pulse into the turbo. And because cylinder number 2 takes such a short amount of time, the exhaust pulses are going to be there pretty much at the same time, thus increasing back pressure. Now, the higher the engine RPM, the smaller the time gap between each individual cylinder firing and each individual exhaust pulse, which means that the restrictive nature of a manifold like this will be most noticeable at higher engine RPMs. Now, sometimes you might hear or read online how exhaust manifold design isn't important on a turbo engine because boost overcomes everything and fixes everything. Of course, in reality, this isn't true. Although boost pressure may mask the shortcomings of an exhaust manifold, because when boost kicks in, the engine is still going to feel fast and powerful, but what you won't be able to feel is how you're wasting some of that boost or engine energy into overcoming the increased back pressure from the exhaust manifold, energy which could be used to turn the wheels instead. But of course, it's not all bad, and OEM cast log style manifolds have some key advantages as well. First of all, they're obviously much smaller, which improves and makes packaging a lot easier, so you can actually stuff the engine together with the turbo and the manifold and everything else into a much smaller engine bay. The shorter runners also means that the exhaust gases take less time to reach the turbo, which of course helps the turbo spool up faster, which improves engine responsiveness. They're also more efficient because the runners are shorter, there's less surface area to dissipate heat, which means that they preserve more of the exhaust heat and energy, which improves efficiency. They're also good for emissions because they allow the turbo and thus the catalytic converter to be mounted closer to the engine. The closer the catalytic converter is to the engine, the faster it heats up and the less emissions there's going to be. Also, they're a lot more cost effective. Unlike aftermarket welded manifolds, which have to be made one at a time, cast log manifolds can be produced in large batches at pretty low prices. Another factor which obviously influences cost effectiveness is the material. Most OEM cast log style manifolds are made from nodular iron. This is one of the most widely available and affordable materials out there. It helps keep the price down, but it also means that even the best cast manifolds will have trouble resisting temperatures above 850 degrees Celsius for prolonged periods of time. In contrast to this, aftermarket welded manifolds are made from stainless steel. 304 stainless steel is a good and common choice, while 321 stainless steel, which this Weldspeed manifold is made from, is an even better choice. Speaking of Weldspeed, definitely check them out. They don't just make beautiful and amazing exhaust manifolds like this one, they also make some really cool intake manifolds, all billet intake manifolds for the 4AGE as well as the 3SGTE and some other engines. Links are down below in the description and the pinned comment. Both 304 and 321 stainless steel are capable of coping with very high temperatures for prolonged periods of time very well. This means that you can drive your car harder for longer, which makes aftermarket welded manifolds much better suited to track driving or motorsport. Compared to 304 stainless steel, 321 steel is more expensive, but it does offer better high temperature fatigue strength, which means that it's less likely to crack or fail no matter what you throw at it. In general, 304 stainless steel is well suited to headers on naturally aspirated cars, while 321 is a good idea for peace of mind on turbo cars. Another benefit of stainless steel is that it obviously creates a smoother internal wall surface, which again helps the gases flow more freely through the exhaust manifold, which helps improve power. When it comes to weight, many people assume that aftermarket manifolds are lighter than cast iron exhaust manifolds due to cast iron being a very heavy material. As you can see, when it comes to our two particular manifolds, that's not really the case. And in general, it's not a good idea to make blanket statements, and weight really depends on the particular individual exhaust manifold. Stainless steel does have a better high temperature resistance, and it's also stronger than cast iron, so you can make it thinner, which means that a stainless steel manifold will be lighter than an equally shaped cast iron manifold. However, most aftermarket manifolds are larger, they have a more intricate shape, they're longer, which of course adds to the weight because more material needs to be used. Another important design concern is of course the diameter of the runners. The smaller the diameter, obviously the greater the back pressure, but also the higher the exhaust gas velocity, which improves turbo spool up and engine responsiveness. The higher the diameter, the lower the back pressure and the higher the ultimate power potential, but also the lower the responsiveness. When it comes to my Weldspeed manifold, it's actually a middle ground between a stock manifold and a full race manifold. A full race manifold is typically going to have even longer runners of an even greater diameter, as well as an additional exit for an external wastegate. In general, an aftermarket manifold is going to increase power by about 5 to 15%. This of course depends on how bad the design of your stock cast log manifold is and how good the design of your aftermarket manifold is. Also, an aftermarket manifold is going to sacrifice a bit of responsiveness in the interest of ultimate power. So, whether it's right for you, of course, depends on your particular application and desired goals and needs. And there you have it. That's pretty much it when it comes to exhaust manifolds. I hope you found this enjoyable, useful, and informative. As always, thanks all for watching, and I'll be seeing you soon with more fun and useful stuff on the D4A channel.